as 1958 began, America sent aloft its first Earth satellite, the Explorer, drawing abreast of Soviet science with three more successful launchings during the year. Then in December, an Atlas ballistic missile guided itself into orbit to become by far the biggest artificial moon. Even more impressive, it carried a tape recording broadcasting to the world the president's message of peace. Man was pushing back frontiers on Earth as well. The atomic submarine Nautilus cruised under the Arctic ice and the North Pole itself. An historic underwater voyage from Hawaii to England. Her sister sub, the Skate, also cruised under the pole, while the nuclear Seawolf set a 60-day underwater endurance record. But Commander Anderson and his men of the Nautilus took first honors for pioneering what may be a key trade lane of the future, demonstrating the awesome power of the nuclear submarine and dramatically directing attention to the strategic Northlands. Fittingly, in that same year, 1958, Alaska finally won its long-sought statehood. Alaskans celebrated with an enthusiasm recalling sourdough days. A new state, twice as large as Texas, joined the Union. A bright new star was added to the 48th. Vice President and Mrs. Nixon toured South America and encountered rabid anti-Americanism, touched off by political ferment and economic troubles. Caracas mobs attacked Mr. Nixon in his car in a shocking climax to his tour. Earlier, communist-led mobs in Peru had stoned the Vice President. Perhaps the prime candidate for Man of the Year was Charles de Gaulle. He returned to the premiership after France came to the brink of civil war when army forces and rightist settlers in strife-torn Algeria seized control and repudiated the Paris government. Given sweeping powers, the general decreed a vacation from politics for France while he prepared a new constitution. The Fifth Republic came into being with an overwhelming Gaullist majority in the new National Assembly. Once again, Charles de Gaulle was his nation's man of destiny. Brussels Fair was a contest for international prestige, and the graceful, airy United States Pavilion, with its cheerful showcasing of America's everyday life, stood in favorable contrast to the looming Soviet exhibition hall. America won a triumph on the cultural front, but the Kremlin, in 1958, took the initiative in the global power struggle. Khrushchev's wooing of Gamal Abdel Nasser brought new upheavals in the Middle East. Strengthened by Soviet arms and economic aid, Nasser began the year by joining Egypt and Syria into the new United Arab Republic. Pan-Arabism was on the march. Nasser was his prophet, and there was dire peril for friends of the West, such as King Faisal of Iraq and his uncle Prince Abdul Ilah, whose attempted united front with Hussein of Jordan was ended by an army-led revolt in Iraq. Faisal, his uncle, and Premier Nouri es-Said, three of Nasser's staunchest foes, were slain in a wave of shocking violence. Neighboring Lebanon, torn by Nasser-incited rebellion, called for aid, and United States Marines landed near Beirut. The landings were only a few hours by air from Soviet frontiers. A possible red attack was the calculated risk of this bold response to Lebanon's call for help. The Marines, by their very presence, were a stabilizing force. The government restored order so that free elections could be held. The crisis passed, and Russia's denunciations and demands for a summit meeting abruptly faded as Red China provoked a new crisis in the Strait of Formosa. Communist guns launched a massive barrage against the Quemoy Island group, nationalist islands barely 3 miles offshore. 50,000 shells landed in one day, beginning a rain of fire intended to cut off supply shipments. Counter the blockade by barrage and the threat of invasion, the U.S. 7th Fleet was reinforced, the mightiest naval force ever assembled. It shepherded Chinese supply convoys to the edge of territorial waters. At first, landing craft were unable to pierce the curtain of fire. But as stockpiled food and supplies ran dangerously low, more and more convoys and airlifts got through. The balance shifted, red gunfire grew sporadic, and the Cold War pressure again shifted abruptly, now to West Berlin, that enclave of freedom 110 miles behind the Iron Curtain. The Free City was a showcase for democracy and capitalism, its obvious prosperity in two-pointed contrast to the regimentation and shabby poverty of the Soviet Hill sector. Red militiamen drilled amid the rubble of World War II. Much of East Berlin is still unreconstructed after more than a decade. Under Den Linden, pre-war Avenue of Elegance typified East Berlin's plight. as Russia demanded that Berlin be neutralized and made free of four-power control. The Soviet flag no longer flew before the Allied Kommandantura as Khrushchev's six-month deadline drew near. The stage was set for another Berlin blockade, or worse, in a bold Soviet gambit threatening the entire balance of power on the continent. The death of Pope Pius, shown with Cardinal Spellman in some of the last films of the Pontiff, stilled one of the world's great voices for humanity. In an age of crisis, he had been among the champions of human rights and the cause of peace. Mourning of half a billion Catholics for the deceased pontiff was followed by keen anticipation as the College of Cardinals met to choose Pius's successor. It was Angelo Cardinal Roncalli who assumed the triple crown of Pope John XXIII, a weighty burden in time of continuing peril to the hopes of all mankind for freedom and peace.